Morning. I invite you to join with me as we pray. Lord God, may that psalm be true of us this morning, that our mouths will praise you forever and forever. Lord God, you are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of glory. And we ask, Father, now that you would speak to us through your word. Cause our hearts to believe and cause our hearts to worship. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. 1940, a man by the name of Mortimer Adler wrote a book. And the title of the book was How to Read a Book. I have it. Believe it or not, this is considered a classic. How to Read a Book. It teaches people how to read books well, various levels of reading, and why to read some books some ways and other books different ways. It might seem kind of self-evident how to read a book, right? But Adler apparently didn't think so, and a number of people have found his book very helpful, very useful. How many of you, any of you have read How to Read a Book? A few. A few of you have read How to Read a Book. I have to confess, that is my copy, and I have not read it. I still don't know how to read a book. So, but I kind of want to follow in Mortimer's footsteps this morning and help us read a particular book. And of course, the book that I'm concerned about is the Word of God, how we read the Bible, and specifically how we read the Old Testament. I think we as Christians sometimes struggle in our reading of the Old Testament, and part of that, at least some degree of that, is how we approach Scripture, how we think about the Bible. One of the ways that we fail in our struggle to read the Bible is when we read the Bible always thinking that we've got to get some sort of a spiritual boost out of it, or an emotional boost out of our reading. This is kind of a very inward and subjective approach to reading Scripture. And of course, there are plenty of passages in Scripture that do that for us. Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I don't know how anyone who's a believer in Jesus Christ can fail to get encouragement and joy and comfort and peace from Romans 8:1, right? There are places in the Old Testament that do that for us. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Countless believers in Christ have received encouragement and joy from passages like this. But what happens if you ever dare into those crinkly pages of the Old Testament law? What do you do with the laws about cleanliness or the laws about food and clothing and all that stuff? This week in my Bible reading plan, I'm doing a chronological reading of Scripture, and I was in Exodus, and I was in those chapters that talk about like the dimensions of the tabernacle and like how many hoops are supposed to be holding up the curtain, and the number of cubits that the curtain is supposed to be, and you know the decorations, the carvings on the candelabra. It's like, what do you do with that? How do you get some kind of blessing from the genealogies in the Old Testament? What do we do with this? It seems to me we're either tempted to ignore those parts of Scripture, or maybe we, you know, sort of grit our teeth and kind of muscle our way through, but we really don't like it. And we sort of wish they weren't there. Possibly even worse is trying to force something out of those texts that isn't really there. Another way we can fail in our reading of the Old Testament is if we read the Old Testament narratives as if they're merely moral stories for us. Like they're just set moral examples for us. It's sort of like reading Aesop's fables, only it's the Bible, and there's always a moral to the story, sort of like, you know, dare to be a Daniel, or, you know, don't be like Cain, or whatever. We walk away with some sort of example some moral teaching. Now, we would be foolish to read the Old Testament and not see the faith of a David or a Daniel or an Abraham and learn from their example. We'd be foolish to read the Old Testament and not learn from the negative example of Abraham and David and these men who failed in some major ways. But the point of the story of David and Goliath is not be like David and have great faith. That's not actually the point. It's a good lesson, but it's not the main point of the passage. Now, there's a lot we could say this morning about reading Scripture and reading the Old Testament specifically. We could talk about how to read various genres of Scripture. We could talk about Old Testament background and history and all those kind of things. And all of those are necessary and good, and we're not going to understand Scripture rightly unless we have that. But what I want to focus on this morning is I want to focus on the big picture of our Bible reading, because it's often the big picture, I think, that gets missed. The Bible is a story. It is a story, and it's God's story. It's possible for us as Christians to know individual Bible stories and miss the Bible story. The Bible is an unfolding drama of what God has done and is doing in this world. It's a story of God rescuing sinners from their sin and folly and condemnation. The story of Scripture is one continuous, unified drama of what God is doing. And Jesus Christ is the focal point. Jesus Christ is the focal point. The Bible, from beginning to end, is one long story about Christ. The point of everything in Scripture is what God has done for his people through Christ. When we read the Old Testament, we have to read it as Christians, as those who believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior and that everything points to him. Charles Spurgeon, speaking of this, said, "We should always read Scripture in this light. We should consider the word to be as a mirror into which Christ looks down from heaven, and then we, looking into it, see his face reflected as in a glass. He looks into the mirror, and we look into the mirror, and we see him in Scripture." And Jesus himself tells us this is true. If you would, open your Bible, please, to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. The setting of Luke chapter 24 is after Jesus' resurrection. A couple of disciples were leaving Jerusalem and walking toward a city called Emmaus, and they come across Jesus. They don't recognize him, and Jesus and the disciples are walking along, talking. And these disciples are both bothered and confused. They're bothered, they're upset, discouraged, because they thought this Jesus would have been the Messiah, and yet he was killed on a cross. And then they're confused because some people had told them that Jesus had risen from the dead. And they don't recognize Jesus. And this is what Jesus says to them in verse 25. Luke 24, 25. And he said to them, "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted them in all the scriptures, the things concerning himself." Jesus just does a good old-fashioned Bible study with these two disciples. And he kept showing them how all of the Old Testament was talking about him. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 1, "All the promises of God find their yes, find their amen in Christ." All the promises of God in the Old Testament are fulfilled in Christ. Christ is the fulfillment of all the Old Testament speaks about. Christ is the point. He is the telos, the end, the conclusion of everything we read in Scripture. Christ is the point from Genesis to Revelation. And so, that should influence how we read the Old Testament. Jesus shows up on the scene in the New Testament. But if everything in Scripture is about him, then how do we read the Old Testament? We have to realize Even though Jesus himself doesn't show up until the New Testament in the flesh, he is spoken of all the way back in the early pages of Genesis. So if you would, turn back to the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 3. Genesis 3. As you know, Genesis chapter 1 talks about the creation of the universe, God creating the world. Genesis chapter 2 focuses in narrowly on God's creation of man and woman in the garden. And as Genesis 2 closes, there is peace. There is a relationship of God's rule over the garden, and the people are lovingly submitting to him. Then in Genesis chapter 3, as you know, man and woman fall into sin. They disobey, and the result is death and destruction and chaos and every form of evil and suffering. And the Lord pronounces a curse on the serpent who deceived them. He pronounces a curse on the earth, a curse on man, a curse on woman. Death is introduced. But even here in Genesis 3, in the midst of judgment, there is a word of good news. Look at Genesis 3:15. I will put enmity, he's speaking to the serpent here, the embodiment of Satan. I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. The Lord makes a promise to the serpent in this verse. And that promise is good news for us. All the brokenness that the fall brought upon the earth would one day be undone. The offspring of the woman would be bruised on his heel by the serpent. But he would in turn bruise the head of the serpent, killing him. Here is the gospel in its earliest form. God is going to rescue his people from their own sin and guilt and destruction. Theologians call Genesis 3:15 the proto-evangelium, the first gospel. It's the first word of good news in the scripture after the fall. And the rest of the Bible is the unfolding of this plan of how God is going to undo the work of the devil and restore mankind to the right relationship with God. All of the rest of the scripture flows out of this. How are we going to get back to the conditions of Eden before the fall, where God reigns and his people lovingly submit to him and his rule is universal? He's going to do that by sending a man, the seed of the woman, to defeat the power of Satan. That man, of course, is Jesus Christ. And the rest of the Old Testament unfolds how God is going to bring about this redemption in Christ. And so, as the story unfolds in Genesis, we talked about a little earlier the genealogies. If you have a King James version of the Bible, it's the begats, right? This guy begat that guy, who begat that guy, who begat that guy. What's the point? Why do we see genealogies in the Old Testament scriptures? It's because we're seeing God be faithful to his promise, and he is separating out a line that the deliverer would come through. And so the line of Cain is separated from the line of godly Seth. And then out of the line of Seth, there's further separation there. Eventually, Noah comes out of the line of Seth, and Noah is separated out from the rest of mankind. Out of the line of Noah, you have the line of Shem, and he is separated out from the rest of mankind. Out of the line of Shem, you eventually get to Abraham, and he is separated out. God is going to bring the deliverer through Abraham. In Abraham, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Even from Abraham, it's not all the sons of Abraham. Out of the line of Abraham, there is Ishmael and Isaac. It is through the line of Isaac the deliverer would come. Out of Isaac, it's not Esau, but Jacob that the deliverer will come. And out of Jacob, the 12 sons of Israel, even there, it's the line of Judah, the line of the kings, that the deliverer would come. And so we read these genealogies. We're seeing God's faithfulness put on display. He will not forget Genesis 3:15. He will not forget the seed of the woman who would come and crush the serpent's head. God chose these people of Israel because out of these people, the deliverer would come. And so he goes down into Egypt and rescues them out of slavery, calling them his own people, redeeming them. And then he gives them the law. And don't turn that around. He calls them his people and then gives them the law. They wouldn't become God's people by keeping the law. They kept the law to stay in right relationship with him so that he could bless them. Deuteronomy outlines the blessings of maintaining the Mosaic covenant. And as they kept the law, God would bless them. And then the nations of the world would see, this is what Israel's God is like. This is what God is doing in the world. And of course, we know Israel doesn't obey, do they? You get to a book like Judges, and it just demonstrates what happens when God's people do what's right in their own eyes. The people needed a leader who would lead them into obedience and blessing. And so God uses Israel's rebellion and rejection of the prophet and judge Samuel to accomplish his purpose of giving them a king. It was God's intention all along that Israel would have a king. Back in Deuteronomy, he gives the regulations for what the king was supposed to be like. And their first king, Saul, showed Israel what happens when your king is like a king of all the nations. So it was David, the man after God's own heart, who was God's true king from the kingly line of Judah. David wasn't a man that other men would have chosen, right? He's out sleeping with the sheep in the pasture while the older brothers are all doing the big important things. He's the runt of the litter. Man wouldn't have chosen David, but he was God's chosen man. And in the reign of David, we get these little glimpses. They're blurry, but we get these little glimpses of what the reign of the Messiah would be like. When there's a king who serves his people and obeys God, and the nation has blessing and prosperity. David's royal line continues through Solomon and down through the centuries of David's descendants, most of whom failed as kings, until finally the kingdom is destroyed. And David's line fails, but God's promise does not. He would yet again have a son of David as king over his people. And the failure of all those Davidic kings just underlines the point that the monarchy in Israel gives us glimpses of the glory of God's kingdom, but never truly attains it. And then we get to the prophets, the Isaiahs and Jeremiahs and Daniels and Ezekiels, and these prophets continue to proclaim the faithfulness of God. He will not forget his promise. The deliverer will come. The servant king will come, right? That day is coming. He will chastise his people for their disobedience, but he will not forget his promises. And we get to the end of the Old Testament, those last few verses in the book of Malachi. And there's this promise of the day of the Lord coming. But it's just sort of hanging out there. When will it be fulfilled? And there's 400 years of silence at the close of the Old Testament. And you can almost, looking back on it, you almost just see the earth just sort of holding its breath. Would God fulfill his promise? How would God fulfill his promise? And then we come to the New Testament. How does it begin? If you're going to tell the story of a deliverer that the world has been waiting for millennia, how would you start it? Let me tell you how you would start it. Not like Matthew starts it, because you know how Matthew starts? Matthew chapter 1 starts with a genealogy, right? Boring. He starts with a genealogy. Why would Matthew start the greatest story ever told with a genealogy? Because Matthew knows the Old Testament. And he's pointing back, and he's saying, God hasn't forgotten his promise. God hasn't forgotten Genesis 3:15. God hasn't forgotten the kingly line of Judah. And here he is. The promise is fulfilled. The seed of the woman has come to crush the head of the serpent. And we have in the pages of the New Testament a record of what Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the deliverer, everything he said and did. He lived a sinless life, died as a sacrifice for sin. And his death and resurrection provide the victory over Satan and death and hell. And now, any who put their faith in Christ find themselves in a restored relationship with God that was lost in the garden. This is the story. And so when we read the Bible, we have to read all of Scripture with this overarching storyline in view. All of Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation, is about the unfolding plan of Christ. And what the Old Testament saints could only see dimly in shadows and shapes, we see clearly because we have the light of Christ. So what does that do for our reading of the Old Testament narratives? We are in our ABFs. I hope all of you are involved in an adult Bible fellowship. And in our ABFs, we've been walking through the life of David. And I thought what we'd do is just zoom in and look at a few of the accounts of the life of David in light of the grand story of Scripture. So I'd invite you to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. This is the story, of course, of David and Goliath. David and Goliath. I mentioned earlier that the point of the narrative isn't that we should be like David, courageously facing our giants. That's a good lesson, but not the actual point of the story. And the answer isn't also to look for hidden meanings in the text, like, what did it mean that David picked up 5 stones? And, you know, throughout history, people have had all kinds of fun with, you know, what those 5 stones meant, or the dimensions of Goliath's armor. There's a number of verses that tell us, you know, how big this breastplate was and his sword and all that kind of stuff. And what do these numbers mean? I think they really just mean he was really big. I think that's kind of the point. What's really important about 1 Samuel 17 is the fact that 1 Samuel 16 comes before it. It's funny how that happens, right? 1 Samuel 16, David is anointed king. And you have to read 1 Samuel 17 in light of that. If you want to place yourself anywhere in 1 Samuel 17 in the story of David and Goliath, it should be in verse 11. Look at verse 11. When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. If you're going to identify with someone in the narrative, it's with the soldiers of the army of Israel. You are one of God's chosen people, but you're unable to conquer your enemy. You need someone to fight for you. David was anointed by God to deliver his people, and that's what he did. The reason why David was successful against Goliath wasn't because he was such a great shot with a sling. It wasn't because he'd learned how to wrestle bears and lions. It wasn't even because he had such great faith. There were many, many people throughout history who've had great faith in God and have died as martyrs, right? And I think it's fair to say there's probably some other soldiers there who had great faith in God. And if they had walked down and met Goliath on the field of battle, they'd have been destroyed. David was anointed to deliver Israel. He was chosen by God to do so. He was God's appointed man to rescue his people. And King David points us ahead to the greater David, the son of David, Jesus Christ, who will stand in our place and defeat our enemies, which we're unable to do ourselves. One commentator says, "We are the hordes of Israelites hiding in our tents, not dealing with the threat of sin, guilt, and death. God's judgment looms over us, as terrifying as the giant Goliath, and we are powerless to stop it. What we need, like Israel, is a representative to challenge this giant of judgment on our behalf." The story of David and Goliath isn't about you and your faith. It isn't even really about David and his faith. The story of David and Goliath is about God and his plan of redemption. God is faithful, and he will deliver his people. And David was a lowercase s savior who delivered Israel from her enemies. And he points us ahead to the greater David, who's the capital S Savior, who delivers his people from eternal destruction. Turn with me, if you will, to the next chapter, 1 Samuel 18. One of the major storylines of 1 Samuel involves the interaction between David and Saul. And Saul's attitude toward David is summed up pretty well in a few of these verses in chapter 18. Look at verse 7. The women sang to one another as they celebrated. Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s. And Saul was very angry, and this saying displeased him. He said, "They've ascribed to David 10,000s. To me, they've ascribed thousands. And what more can he have but the kingdom?" And Saul eyed David from that day on. Verse 12, after he tries to kill David. Verse 12, Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him but had departed from Saul. Verse 15, and when Saul saw that he had great success, he stood in fearful awe of him. And literally the next 10 or 12 chapters of 1 Samuel just detail what it's like for David when the king wants you dead. Right? He flees from Saul, goes here, goes there, the whole time being chased. Saul wants him dead. David has this little ragtag group of malcontents around him, but he's no match for those who are in power. I want you to stop and think about this for a minute. Imagine you're on that road from Jerusalem to Emmaus, walking along behind those disciples and Jesus. Do you think there's any chance that Jesus went back here to 1 Samuel and talking about why the Messiah had to suffer? Do you think there's some chance that Jesus said, you know, the Messiah was the son of David, and David suffered. David was anointed king and then went through years of suffering before he was exalted as king. Don't you think maybe the son of David, who was anointed king, would have to suffer even to the point of death before being exalted as king at the right hand of God the Father? In our ABF, we talked a lot through these chapters about how David's wanderings in the wilderness and being persecuted prepared him to be king, right? Gave him compassion for those who were suffering and so forth. He could identify with those who are in difficulty because of what he went through. And the book of Hebrews tells us that Jesus had to be made like his brothers in every way, that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God in order to make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he's able to help those who are being tempted. David's suffering, David's persecution at the hand of Saul points us ahead to the greater David and the suffering that he would go through. And while David was being chased by Saul, did he ever have a chance to take vengeance on Saul? Absolutely. Several times. One time, Saul comes in to relieve himself in a cave, and there's David just a few feet away hiding out. He could have just easily stood up and chopped off his head. No problem. Even encouraged to do so by some of his men. And David refuses to touch the Lord's anointed. Refused to take vengeance. Does that remind you of someone? 1 Peter says of the greater David, Jesus Christ, he committed no sin, neither was deceit in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. These chapters of 1 Samuel tell us that David's suffering at the hands of Saul find their fulfillment in Christ. Last place in the Old Testament I want to look this morning, 2 Samuel chapter 7. If you're in ABF, you just studied this, so it's not my intention to rehash anything. But I couldn't help but just make a few comments here. 2 Samuel 7, David wants to build the Lord a house. And the Lord flips that around and says, no, David, I'm going to build you a house. By a house, of course, he doesn't mean a physical structure. He means a family line. Let's pick it up in verse 12. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be to him a father. He shall be to me a son. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him with the rod of men, with the stripes of the sons of men. But my steadfast love will not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I put away from before you. And your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." The obvious question here, who is the Lord talking about? The answer is Solomon. It's obvious. Solomon came from David's body. Solomon was the next king of Israel. God established Solomon on the throne. Solomon committed iniquity, and the Lord disciplined him, chastised him. Solomon is the fulfillment. And yet, Solomon isn't the fulfillment, right? He's not the full and final fulfillment. God had promised in verse 16 that David's line would never fail, and his kingdom would be sure forever. And yet, a couple hundred years after this, the line of David's king failed. The kingdom was destroyed. And since that day, no one from the line of David has ever again sat on a physical throne over the nation of Israel. Did God's promise fail? No. Solomon was never intended to be the final fulfillment of this promise. There is a son of David sitting on his throne. And that king is Jesus, seated at the right hand of God. He's not recognized as king by this world. But that day is coming. And this promise is about him. And every promise in Scripture is about him. The godly kings of Israel foreshadow him. The ungodly kings of Israel are contrasted with him. The law was a tutor to bring us to him. The Psalms sing of him. Every prophecy is ultimately about him. All of Scripture has to be read and understood in relationship to Jesus Christ. It's all about him. Everything in the past, everything recorded in Scripture, all of this history is about him. And, gloriously, everything in the future is about him. And I want to finish in the last book of the Bible, in Revelation. The book of Revelation. Turn to Revelation 21. I was supposed to finish in Revelation 22, but I just couldn't help talking a little bit about Revelation 21. Revelation 21. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God.'" Look at verse 3. The dwelling place of God. That word dwelling place is the word tabernacle. Same word used in John chapter 1. "And the word became flesh and tabernacled among us," dwelt among us. Now I'll go back to my reading this week. Exodus 26, pretty dry, pretty boring. Wood, building, structure, cubits, the whole deal, right? What was that really about? God had said, "I will dwell with you. I will come and meet you in the tabernacle." But he would only meet with Moses and with the high priest, not with all the people. John chapter 1, God became flesh. And the tabernacle was right here. People touched him. People hugged him. God becoming flesh, tabernacling among his people. And one day in the new heaven, in the new earth, God will dwell with us once again. He will tabernacle with us. That tabernacle and all of those instructions were all meant to point ahead to a day when God would dwell with his people forever. That's what it's all about. It's all about Christ. Chapter 22, next chapter. We've come full circle now. From the first garden to the last garden. Here's what the future holds. Revelation 22, verse 1, "Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. Also on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, his name will be on their foreheads, and night will be no more. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, the curse is reversed. His servants will worship him in holiness forever and ever. The offspring of the woman has crushed the head of the serpent. Finally, look at verse 12. This is Jesus talking. Behold, I'm coming soon, bringing my recompense with me to repay everyone for what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. We could say the Genesis and the Revelation. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life, and then that they may enter the city by the gates, outside of the dogs and the sorcerers and the sexually immoral and murderers and idolaters and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you about these things for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. All of history has been about Jesus Christ, and all of our hope for the future is found in him. The Puritan Richard Sibbes said this: heaven is not heaven without Christ. It's better to be in any place with Christ than to be in heaven itself without him. All delicacies without Christ are but a funeral banquet. What is all without Christ? I say the joys of heaven are not the joys of heaven without Christ. He is the very heaven of heaven. It's all about him. It's all about him. When you read the scriptures, read them in light of him, and let the scriptures take you to him. And if Christ is the point of your Bible reading, then Christ is the point of your life. It's all about him. Let your life point to Jesus Christ, because all of history and all of the future is about him. Let's pray. Our Father, we confess that if left to ourselves, we tend to make everything about us. We live for ourselves. We love ourselves. We can even turn our reading of the Bible into another way to focus on ourselves. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us for missing the point of it all, the grace and mercy you have shown to us in Christ. Lord God, we praise you for the amazing wisdom and the plan of redemption that you've unfolded. Teach us, Lord, to see everything in light of who you are and what you've done for us in Christ, and in light of who we are in Christ. Lord, you are worthy of all of our praise, and we praise you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite the congregation to stand for the closing benediction. Now go in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. You're dismissed.